Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Again, welcome to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. As you can notice, I don't have my cover today. I'm out of uniform. Don Dupay was going to be on the second part of the show. He recognized it and he said, Bruce, he gave me some demerit and asked me to do 50 push-ups in the front of him. I did 60.
One-handed.
Right, exactly. But anyway, sorry about that. But anyway, I will mention the fact that to the vets, like we always do, and that is if a vet is not registered with the VA, if you will, and get that card, the point is that there are benefits there for them. So if you're a family member out there and you've got a vet at home, or you got an uncle or an aunt, talking about females too, anybody that was former military should check into the VA and get that card and see whether or not they've gotten any benefits. All you need is your last four. Most vets understand what I'm talking about, the last four. That's the last four numbers of your Social Security number. But anyway, I've got this manual here. Basically, it talks about the whole deal. Know your benefits. You can pick one of those up at the VA. But to get one, if you'd like to get one, or just basically get it, just sort of an overview of the vet's benefit, you can call this number, and it's right up in this particular piece, too, by the way. It's 1-800-827-1000. Again, 1-800-827-1000. So please, contact the vet and get them over there. Even if it's just a homeless vet, anything along those lines, the benefits are there. Just call that number, and you can go from there, okay? So now, let's get down to the show. It's going to be a very interesting show today, and you're going to like the format of the show. When we were running for mayor, I say my team was running for mayor of the city of Portland, one of the things we were very interested in and trying to figure out how do we solve some problems within the city of Portland, because in all due respect, the city of Portland is kind of like the living room of Oregon, when you think about the living room of Oregon. And we were covering, at that particular time, we were covering a land issue, Bureau of Land Management, and there was what was the name of that?
The Bundys.
It was the Bundys issue aspect of it. And anyway, we had a show, and Don was on it too and all, and one of the things we said that we figured we needed a process. And the process would be that if a person wants to come and march or demonstrate or basically First Amendment right and share their thoughts and whatever, the idea was to come, go and file at the city of Portland, and then go before the city of Portland. There's a Wednesday gathering, if you will, where the mayor and the commissioners tend to educate communicate the last week issues of the city of Portland, whatever. And the person would be able to, at that point in time, share why their rationale, why they're having, if you will, the march, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then once they've done that, and then the commissioners and the mayor would vote as to whether or not they felt this would be something that would be of benefit to the livability of the city of Portland, but at the same time, be aware, let the people be aware of what's going on, what's to be done. And then that's okay, they get signed off on this deal, and then it's fine. This way people know that that there will be a march, because that's live video too, by the way. That's on the tube, that comes out of the tube aspect. But the idea is that the people would know that there would be a march there on a Saturday, because Saturday is a very important day to all of us for that matter, because yes, you like to get out the house, go downtown, walk the street, whatever's necessary. So anyway, we did that. But anyway, but now what we're doing is we're doing this particular segment. We're going to do something on an event that happened here in the Portland metropolitan area when a young man, by another videographer, news person, his name was I'm sorry.
Mike Strickland.
Mike Strickland. Yeah, I have to know the guy because he worked on the campaign. But it's getting a little timing in there. But anyway, that was a little event that happened. And so we were just going to take the opportunity to kind of rehash, if you will, that so-called idea of what we thought the city could do about the whole issue of marches and the activities in the city of Portland. And got someone here that this is a good example of it. And we're going to have him share with us, talk about the whole issue of Mike Strickland, what that's all about, aspect of it. This way, that's one part of it. On the other part that's left out is that the city of Portland, because when you think about the city of Portland and those elected officials, they really are employees of the voters.
Of course.
See, so the whole idea, we're doing that. We're educating the public as to what went on, and he's going to talk about an event, an upcoming event, right?
Yes.
And it's an event about supporting whatever his issues are or whatever. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to my man Leo. And Leo is, like I said, he's kind of like a media guy like us. We're not fake news, but, you know, we're there, right? Okay, Leo.
I just try to get it out there so everybody sees what really happens and not how it's wanted to be conveyed by any particular news source.
Exactly. So, Leo, let us know. What is it?
Well, I have are you talking about what I do personally or the issue with Mike?
Well, no, you can just briefly deal about the person because we fall in the same vein.
Okay, yeah. Basically, you know, Mike was downtown. He has a YouTube channel, and it's called Laughing at Liberals. And for those who aren't really in the know, I wasn't before. I got my own YouTube channel. He has, I want to say, over 20,000 subscribers and millions of views. Mm-hmm. So he's very proficient, and he also writes blogs for other very influential other sources of on media. So he's very prolific, but he's very passionate about the Second Amendment and a lot of First Amendment things. And being Oregon and having kind of a honestly very progressive city government, and really at the state level as well, he knows that they're always trying to be like your Washington D.C.'s, your California's, your New York City, where there are absolutely no gun rights whatsoever. And, you know, that may represent a small portion of the state, but there's an entire rest of the state that, is aware of their rights, their Second Amendment rights, and, you know, very much need them. And so he would go and do videos of like city council meetings and like little breakout things where, say, just a name to throw out there, Jeannie Burdick, for example, would have a town hall in her neighborhood. And, kind of like when Barack Obama was saying that individuals cling to their guns, their God, and whatever, because he was in San Francisco. They kind of do the same thing. They speak to, they just think their own constituents. But he would come and film it, and then those things would get out to everybody. And so that kind of made him unpopular amongst some
of those
individuals.
But that was his background. He was a videographer.
Yeah, yeah.
He was a newsprint kind of a videographer.
And then he also, when they were trying to pass some new Second Amendment laws in following Sandy Hook situation, they saw it as an opportunity to, we can use this to get some of these stricter gun laws and enforcements that we wanted. He was a big part of the individuals that were going down to Salem and testifying before the Senate.
Okay.
And those got put up as well. So it was very well known the Second Amendment was something that was very
and that's okay.
Important. Yeah, yeah, that, exactly.
Whether it be anti, whether it be pro, but that's where he was.
Yeah.
But he still was a videographer, newsman,
person. Right, exactly.
So what about this particular incident?
He also, Portland does a lot of the Black Lives Matter, Hands Up, Don't Shoot, Ceasefire Oregon, all of those types of groups. They're very active. And, he goes and he films those as well. So he's recognized from those events, and he does great work. So he's good at editing and telling the story, and it gets out to your Breitbarts and things of that nature. So it gets well out there. So he was going to, I believe this was following maybe the Michael Brown verdict, case verdict. And things
was during that particular time.
Yes. Things had come to a head, and he had gone down to the Portland State area, down there on the campus, which is where a lot of these things occur, from there basically up to, like, City Hall and the park blocks. That area is where it's real popular to do this, and up to Pioneer Courthouse Square, the city's neighborhood, as you had said. Yeah. And so he'd went down there and was filming, and there were individuals that were basically kind of within the groups had said, you know, we need to do something about Mike because he's creating problems.
So it was a Black Lives Matter event, so to speak.
It also was hands up, don't shoot. But the Black Lives Matter, I think, is the most recognized nationally amongst the groups. So
in all
kind
due respect, we give credit to Theresa Griffin because she's recognized in the Portland metropolitan area as the Black Lives Matter.
Right. Okay. So I think of all of the groups, like Hands Up, Don't Shoot and all that, the ones that's really has taken the most hold traction has been Black Lives Matter.
So that's nationwide, too.
Portland, Oregon, it's exactly.
Ready. Okay, yeah. Good. So then what happened?
Well, he was down there, and he was just filming. Well, let me back up just a little tiny bit. About maybe an hour before that, there was a separate little rally at Pioneer Courthouse Square, and there was an individual there there were a few Black Panthers there, and they were angry, and they were riling up the group, and the individual was there, there's video of this, of him saying, if the cops come around and they threaten you, you need to pull out your gun and shoot them type thing, and he was just, and I'm not going to use the language they're using, but I mean, it was extreme. And there's video out there to prove this, that it occurred. Well, that individual then came down to where Mike was, as well as some of these other individuals that he had crossed earlier just by having videos of them. And they kind of converged on him. And there was it was almost like a hit on him that was put on him to go down there and take care of him to try and, encourage him. Physically.
Now, this was being shared also too in the trial, right?
Well, I'm not sure how much of it is allowed.
That was a federal trial. Yeah. That was a federal trial.
Yeah.
Okay. And for the benefit of for the viewing audience, let them know. You need to let them know now about what did Mike do?
Okay. So anyway, these individuals were convening on him and threatening him, and he has his concealed carry permit. He went through all the training and everything, and he had a 9mm or something with him, a Glock, and he simply pulled it out and waved it in the air. And he had what they tell you is as a safety thing, you put your finger above the trigger carriage there, and not on the trigger unless you're about to pull it. So you can clearly see on video when they have of him doing this, that his finger is on above on the side of the gun, and he simply waves it around and he says, "Back off." Now, there's another individual that's kind of amongst more of the protesters groups, but I give him credit. He came and he said, let him get out of here. He's scared.
So what did Mike do? Did Mike pull the weapon?
He pulled it out and he
was on video that day.
Yeah, he did that and then he put it back down. Well, at the point that he pulled it out, they seized upon I think part of it was to get him to try and do that, to try and provoke him. And if they couldn't take him out physically, legally, then they knew that he was a Second Amendment person. They provoke him to pull the gun out, and then they could say, "Hey, look, well, he's threatening us," okay. which happened.
Okay. I might add, too, that you did give me the opportunity to look at some of the videos.
Okay.
And you shared those because you posted them out there, and people were able to see those, too. So I would suggest that if you'd like to see some of those, you can Google it, right? You can Google it?
Yes.
And is there a website?
I would actually recommend Victoria Taft,
okay,
who is she used to actually have a radio show here, and now she's down in Los Angeles.
Okay.
But she has done several process
on
throughout
this,
the
on
trial
this
on this particular piece,
okay,
where
okay.
she's put.
So if they Google her name, would they get it?
Yes.
So if they Google Victoria Taft.
Yeah, Victoria
right?
Taft.
Victoria
yes.
Taft.
And then
Mike Strickland.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mike Strickland.
Yes. She's done basically like almost a symposium.
And everything that you've
said
and more, and then they have the opportunity to see that.
Yeah, exactly. And see it in the time frame and everything else.
So now that I'm just trying to move ahead a little bit because of the time. Now you, you, you want, there's going to be an event. Yeah, I know they're keeping work.
Yes.
Let's talk about that event
real quick, right? Well, Mike, within our community, because I also do similar things to what he does,
right.
He's always been so gracious with me and helpful.
Okay.
And we kind of got to look out for each other.
Okay.
I am going to have on tax day, April 15th.
April 15th.
There is a significance to that.
Okay.
It's tax day.
All right. All right.
Tax burden.
Okay.
Anyway.
You know what I call it? Rent day.
Rent day?
Yes. Everybody got to pay their rent, right?
That's
okay,
true.
All
that's
right,
true.
All right.
Okay, so on rent day.
On rent day.
On
there
Bruce's
you go.
Rent
there
day
you
on the 15th.
No, all of our rent day.
Okay,
yours
I know.
Too.
But I'm giving you credit for
okay.
for the rent thing. I didn't come up with that. So
Don don't pay any rent. He I'm trying to get like him.
Okay. Anyway, on that particular day, Saturday at 12 o'clock down at City Hall, down there on, 4th Street or whatever.
Right. Okay.
Can't miss it. I am having a rally to support Mike Strickland,
okay.
where a lot of individuals that I've invited are just going to come down. We're going to have
right
speakers.
Right at City Hall?
Yeah, right there.
Right at City Hall?
City Hall.
By what time?
12 o'clock.
By 12 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep.
I take it have you gone in and gone through the process in terms of
I went
file?
I went to get a permit, and they said you don't need one because it's City Hall. It's city property.
Okay.
But what the benefit was they are letting the police force know.
Yeah, okay.
And that way they will make sure that everything is safe for everybody.
Okay.
And we're going to have speakers there that will go further into depth about your Second Amendment rights in the state of Oregon.
Cool. So you're going to have a press conference there. Press conference, and people are going to be there handing out flyers again, bringing the point up. The point is the whole idea is to maybe look at a repeal of some sort, because that right up front with he has been, was it temporarily sentenced or whatever?
Well, originally occurred is he had, they posted bail, so he's been on bail.
Posted bail.
And then he went back in and was sentenced. He will be sentenced in May.
Since it's May.
Mm-hmm,
okay.
And he's got like 20 counts against him. They got him on every single
thing.
How
much time possibly?
Like 50 years or more.
50 years. Wow, that's a pretty heavy piece.
So
the whole idea is to try to get this thing back to the table, so to speak.
The idea
is to...
be
in a position when the judges got ready to basically make this particular point, right? Or sentence, whatever happens after that, you want to make sure that the word's out there, right?
That, and Mike is a single young man, mm-hmm. and he's not married or anything. I don't know much about his family, but he's always had our back.
Okay.
He's gone out there for our cause.
Yeah.
We want him to know that we have his back as well.
Okay. So I was going to go back real quick, like on as far as the weapon was concerned.
Mm-hmm.
Now you said he had a concealed weapons permit.
Yes.
Right? How long has he had that permit?
As far as I know, several years.
And did he apply here in Multnomah County in Portland?
Yes, I believe so.
He did,
yes, because he's been a resident here, so I think he would have
to. So was police aware of the fact that, or did he make the police aware of the fact that he's carrying a weapon while he's videoing?
Well, what happened is once he pulled it and then he put it back down and they backed off, then he saw the police and he went over and he surrendered himself to the point where he went down, and you can see in the video he kneels down, puts his arms out, and is.
But I guess my point is that I'm just a thought. Mm-hmm. What came to my mind when you made the point about the fact that he was carrying a concealed weapon permit, he had a permit, the whole nine yard aspect of it. Did he make the officers aware of the fact that he had a weapon before he went out there?
I don't know.
Okay,
that I don't know.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. I know what you're saying. Yeah,
we'll make that point. If he said that, and then if the police says it's okay, then cool. And they'll give him the criteria, blah, 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 routine. Maybe check him out or something like that. Or they might have said, no, you can't do that.
Well, he's very aware, being that he covers all this, he knows where you can and can't have even a second. Because there's, like colleges, for example, you cannot have on college campuses in the state of Oregon concealed, even though it's okay to have it in other areas. So he's very acute to where you can have it and where not. He knows it. Sideways and upside down.
But let's keep it in a positive vein from the standpoint. Let us say, okay, fine, maybe he might get probation or maybe he might lower that sentence and whatever. But at the end of that day, hopefully it's something we might learn, folks like yourself and whatever that's out there. They may say, well, okay, fine, maybe part of that process is that before they get out there and do whatever, they will at least advise talk to them, or at least indicate to the police department, police, whoever, that they do have a weapon.
Yeah,
and if it's and if is it okay for me to blah 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 routine, And if they said no, then boom, he just said, fine. He's still sitting in the car locked up.
Right.
Or he'll take it out and do it.
But at the same time,
but
I mean,
it's a discussion.
But it is, you know, the Second Amendment apply. And
I'm agreeing. Yeah. I'm agreeing with you.
And this also goes to the First Amendment. That's one thing important that I really want to tell people coming to this event. This is also about your First Amendment rights.
Right.
And they
right.
basically shut down all of his, he's not allowed to go to do anything. He can't do any filming. They took all of his equipment. He can't be on social media, nothing. I mean, they have him, and that's a First Amendment issue. That's a, if you want to shut down somebody's First Amendment, and that affects people who maybe don't even like guns.
Well, you know,
because it goes to,
well, Leo, in all due respect, that's one of the reasons why I have you here, because see, it's very important that we get the media out there.
Yes.
You know what I mean? To tell the story as to the rationale. That's why I said we need a process, if you will, when there is a march.
Right.
And then hopefully have and understand the rationale for having media. I mean, we're having this question now about fake media and this, that, and the other, whether or not what you can believe, this, that, and the other. So the name of the game is that this whole exercise that we're going through, and using Mike, in all due respect, naturally thinking about Mike, but at the same time, what Mike has brought to the table,
yes,
if you will,
yes,
is to see how can we clean, get this stuff to the point that
I don't want him to be a sacrificial lamb.
That's right.
One hand,
that's
but on
right.
the other hand, people need to know that.
That's right.
Just, and this goes back to what you said about the BLM, as in Bundy's and stuff.
Right.
It's the same thing. They were trying to do the same thing.
Thing.
Is to understand that your rights as an American citizen under the Constitution are being infringed upon.
Right.
And if you don't address it, if you aren't aware of it, then you're the next, you could be the next person.
Right,
I could be the next person. You could be the next person.
Right.
And that's just
This has been
shameful.
Great, man. Well, like I said, since it's April what now again?
It's April 15th. What did you call it? Rent day?
Yeah, rent day.
Or tax day for the rest
of
the country.
I like that. We got that brand. Don's got that. You got that. Okay, so the whole idea is that it's going to be on April 15th,
yes.
right? Which is tax
City Hall,
day, tax day or rent day aspect of it. And it's going to be at 12 noon.
12 noon, yes.
You've got your permit. Everything
yes.
is all squared away.
Permit.
The officers are very familiar with that. And I'm sure no one's going to be carrying their weapon unless they check they check it in with the officers.
I specifically asked, due to my situation, let's not even open carry anything. This is all about Mike, and we don't want to hurt his case.
Right,
this
is to
support him and just an informational thing.
Well, you know, like I said, nobody wants to get shot, and in all due respect, I damn sure don't want anybody out there carrying a weapon, and they don't have the right to do it. Maybe we might even want to consider having it on a waterfront, if you will, and putting the detectors on it there. And people walk in, and they get the whole open area. Anything to save lives. That's
well, you know, one thing I can honestly say is a lot of the people that are have said they're coming amongst the group of people that I've invited, which has been over 1,000. They're very respectful of their rights. They understand it, but they aren't going to make other people uncomfortable because this is a family event.
Okay.
And you
don't care.
What I hear you saying,
do not carry weapons at City Hall.
Yeah.
That's what I hear you saying.
Yeah, and it's a respectful thing. And
yes.
And you want to teach your kids that you can come down and have an event where you're just learning from each other and not have to be scared of each other.
Yeah, might be a better deal if you feel that you still want to insist to carry the weapon. Check in with the Portland Police, if you're in Portland, check in with Portland Police Department and say, hey, look, I want to carry my weapon. I'm going to carry my weapon. They'll tell you yes or no. And then if they say no and you say you're still insisting, then go to court. Get it squared away before you have the event. Fair?
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, but it's going to be safe there.
No.
It really is.
But I understand. I know yours will be safe. One, I'll probably be there just to, you know, to make sure.
Oh, I'd love to have you.
And the other thing we're going to do, Leo, we're going to have you back on before that day.
Okay,
too.
Great.
Which,
great.
To make sure that people know.
Yes.
Make sure that they're aware of what's going on.
Yeah, the media will be there. I've contacted some of them.
And besides Victoria Taft talking about the issue, do you have the announcement on your page at all?
Yes, I do.
What is it? Why don't you share it with
me? It's my page is on the YouTube.
Okay.
Just under Leo Stratton.
Leo Stratton. Just Leo Stratton.
LeoStratton. Yes.
Okay, you got it. Leo, this is going to be great, okay?
Yeah, and actually, if you want to find it, most easily put in your Google search, support Mike Strickland Rally.
Awesome. I like it.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Thanks, Leo.
Thank you.
Okay,
for
folks,
we're
going to take a short break, and then we're going to come back with our next guest, okay? Be right back.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Folks, the Oregon Voter Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host, and this is going to be kind of like a wrap-up day kind of a deal. A lot of things have been happening over the last week or so and whatever, and we've come up with a whole new format here on the Oregon Voter Digest. We're going to probably have a few additional hosts, if you will, to cover varying areas around the state, around the city, and some other specific areas, and you're going to kind of get a sense of that's where we're going to be going with this deal. This way we can get the information out to you. Because, in all due respect, we need communication. We need to communicate. I mean, we're having a problem with this fake news and all that good stuff. And all due respect, indirectly, everything is sort of fake news to a certain degree. Because once they interview a person and then they write it down, it's totally different than the other person. But the fact of the matter is, we still need to get the information out. And so the Voters Digest is going to try to do as much as we can with that here at Portland Cable Media. So again, welcome again.
The difference between us and them.
What's that?
The difference between us and them.
Yes, what is it?
They're selling commercials, we're not.
That's right. That's a good one.
That's what they're doing.
See, that's why Don is here. See? Okay, thank you, Don. Well, anyway, here's Theresa. In fact, Theresa got the first one. I'm sort of like the chairman of the host, so to speak. But Theresa's got her show. She's got that going right now. She did her first show.
Yeah.
She's done several shows, but my point is that she did under her own hosting piece aspect of it. She's done one show. And then we've got other individuals that have been on, and hopefully we got Fred Stewart, who's sitting here right now. And Fred, in all due respect, he's a history person walking along in terms of communication. He's run for office before. He's been in real estate. In fact, he's been in real estate in an area here in the Portland metropolitan area, i.e., quote, that's been identified as the minority area. But really, it's not a minority. It's an area of Portland, if you will. But he's done more. He's sold more homes in that area and knows more about that terrain. And he has been born and raised here, if you will. He's got all sorts of background. So in all due respect, you'll probably be seeing his face here periodically because he has a lot of background material that he can share with us. From the standpoint of making our place a better place to live. And then we got, you've seen Don Dupay. Don and I ran for mayor this last time around. It was great. And Don is a former Portland policeman. And his area was Northeast Portland.
Absolutely.
Well, I say if you're Portland police, your area was Portland, Oregon. in some cases, Oregon, for that matter. But Don's got quite a bit of knowledge. You've seen him, you've heard him before, and then you can check him out on Facebook. You can check all of us out on Facebook, and we tend to communicate in that arena, too. But I just want you to know that that's the direction that the Voters Digest is going to be going. So what we're going to be doing today, and we're going to be doing something like this similarly every so often, kind of like a recap, bringing these various individuals on, and then just sharing what they felt they got out of their respective shows, okay? So there we are right now, and here we go. So I'm just going to throw this on just as a kind of a little deal, show you how excited we are about this thing. City of Portland, right now, what's the biggest thing we got? The homeless. We're talking about housing, you know what I mean? We're talking rent control. We got all kinds of good stuff. So we're going to kind of throw that out there on the table. Then there was another little incident that happened the other day. And Theresa caught it, the media person. She put it out there on Facebook. The word nigger was used, I mean, right here in Portland area, Portland metropolitan area, downtown parks, if you will. And this guy basically, white guy, hit this young white, black guy, kid. And next thing you know, he said, go to Africa or something. What was the quote?
Get your ass back to
get your nigga ass back to Africa or something like that. But we don't believe in that kind of stuff. So the fact of the matter is, we do have an issue, an image issue in the state of Oregon, for that matter, being the whitest state and the whitest city or whatever. But the fact of the matter is, that's not where in our arena. And I think about Tom McCall when he made that first hit. Tom McCall, former governor of Oregon, when he made the point about visit but don't stay. I mean, we were making that point at that point in time. And then former Governor Vic Attia came back and pulled the sign down. And so, look like we're going to be putting it back up for a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
So, but the fact of the matter is, that was an issue that was out there.
It was released recently, a story.
Real quickly, what's the update on that?
The video was released March 8th. And it pertains to a situation that happened, I think, in 2013.
Okay, now suppose you got that. That's what we are.
An older white man basically assaulted and continued to try to assault a young African-American male on his skateboard, just a kid. Okay. And it was just recently released.
Okay. And you're still looking at that possibility. You still might be able to get the with a jacket, if you will.
I might be able
background.
To find something out.
Yeah, find out whether or not when it happened and what was the circumstances and what happened to the happened to the guy who made that statement.
Well, he was arrested for a hate crime.
He went to jail. How long? 20 years? Did they throw the keys away?
No.
They didn't throw the keys away. Don?
I don't think so.
Can you get the jacket?
We'll try.
No, but he went to jail. That's the important part.
He went to jail. Okay.
Justice was immediate.
Okay, and he lied, and he lied on camera.
Okay. The next big issue was the whole issue of housing. Okay. And where are we, Fred?
Well, we're in a mess. You know, we've got a city commission that is basically raising rents on people right now by pushing for rent control. I mean, this is an unprecedented move by not just the city of Portland, but any progressive government in Oregon history. What they've decided to do is get rid of no-cost evictions and... When a landlord kicks somebody out, they have to pay for the moving expenses for that tenant to move someplace else.
Which can be between $3,000 and $5,000, right?
Oh, easy.
Yeah.
Easy.
Wow.
It can be between $3,000 and $5,000. And it's like, you know, I was talking with a landlord the other day who found out that recently one of his tenants has been convicted of basically a sex offense, a pretty nasty sex offense. And what he would normally do is give a tenant like that a no-cause eviction. Just say, you know, you've been convicted of a crime, basically. I'm kicking you out. No landlord wants to go through a fight over that.
Right.
But they also don't want a sex offender living around the women and children in their buildings either.
Right.
So what they would normally do is give a no-cause eviction. Well, in this case, he can't do that unless he wants to pay the freight for a guy who's just been convicted. And you say, well, if he's convicted, how come he's still... you know, in a, in his home, because guys, gotta remember, this is Oregon. You have to be pretty heinous. You have to do a pretty bad sex offense in order to go to jail. This guy's gonna be on house arrest for a while, and he's got probation. You know, I mean, I think what he's done is bad enough for Measure 11, but. You know, that's my opinion, and, you know...
Well, Fred...
Not the DA's opinion, but the bottom line is, we got a landlord who's got a sex offender living on his property.
Right.
He doesn't want him there. But he also doesn't want to pay $3,000 to $5,000 to move him.
So instead of giving him a no-cause eviction, he has to evict him, right?
Well, that's not really a cause. I mean, that's what his attorney said. There's nothing in, you know, he didn't commit the crime at home. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm talking about? And actually, he committed this crime before he became a tenant.
Okay.
You understand? Uh-huh. But the point is, you know, what are the odds that you're going to spend all this money, get in front of a judge, and a judge is going to say, well, the fact that he committed a crime someplace else is good enough for you to kick him out of here.
Okay.
But I can assure you what he's convicted of, no female is going to want to live around him, and especially if that female has children.
Mm-hmm.
But this landlord's hands are tied. Mm-hmm. You know, he can kick him out and pay $3,000 to $5,000.
That's one incident. Mm-hmm. But the whole issue of rent control, now that's huge right now. In fact, a city council person just got elected that position. That was her platform.
Yeah. Rent control has...
So what's the fairness on this whole issue?
Rent control has never worked. Because when you put a cap on revenue, but not a cap on expenses, you know, basically what you lead into what landlords are going to do is every time a property turns over,
mm-hmm.
they're going to raise the rents even higher than normal. We're seeing landlords already raising rents 30% on turnover in anticipation for rent control being in eventually. So it's just like in San Francisco. I mean, the average house, the average 3-bedroom, 2-bath house, you can look it up yourself, right now rents for about $5,500 a month.
Wow.
You know, I don't see anything affordable. The other problem with rent control is rent control usually ends up eliminating black people and people of color from living in those markets. So if you look at San Francisco and the rent control markets, and especially the rent control buildings, that are the best located in the city, there are no black people in them unless those black people are wealthy.
You mentioned that once before on Facebook. You said that most of the rent-controlled buildings are managed by white people, and they move in their friends and their family mm-hmm. who are white, and then black people get pushed out.
Well, didn't HUD respond to that early on?
HUD came down a little bit over the years on both California, Chicago, and a couple other places, but... You know, and President Obama, when he was president, was beginning to lead into it. HUD was beginning to get into it again. But, I mean, we've got, you know, President Trump now. And President Trump has literally made billions of dollars off of rent control.
Well, a lot of folks did.
I know, but he... So the odds of HUD right now stepping in and protecting people of color, and especially the very poor of any color, is very unlikely.
What can we do in Oregon? In fact, Don had a question.
New York City's had lots of experience with rent control. How did it work out there?
It didn't work out very well. I mean, especially in Manhattan. And the last place they hit it was with in Harlem.
Okay.
And it's right now being blamed as one of the reasons why it's basically being depopulated of black people. So imagine Harlem right now.
Is becoming white?
It's becoming extremely white. And because what happened is as soon as rent control hit... And it hasn't hit the entire market, it's just hit parts. But what happens is rents start going up in one section and it just goes right on through.
All right.
So landlords are raising their rents in anticipation for rent control. They don't want to be caught in one of those old situations where somebody has rent that's stuck for 30 or 40 years. And you also got to remember another thing. Most of the rent control increases isn't caused by the landowner. It's caused by the lessee subleasing space out or the entire property out to other people. So you get a person...
What do you mean by that?
Well, a lessee will rent the property, and let's say they rent it at $1,000 a month.
Okay.
They may, you know, have like 3 bedrooms or 2 bedrooms, doesn't matter.
Okay.
They'll rent 1 bedroom out at $1,000 a month.
Okay.
So they live there for free. Or maybe they'll rent the whole thing out for $1,500 and move out.
Okay.
You understand? A wise landlord will prevent that. You may not sublease.
You really can't prevent that, and I'll explain to you why.
If they got the lease
already. Because they're not there.
You've got to prove, one, that they've done it.
Yeah.
Two, you've got to hire a lawyer and go to court. No, you do, because you got to remember, we don't have no-cause eviction.
It's true. And the other thing is that the landowners are often living in another state.
Correct.
And they're managed.
I mean,
you know,
it increases the amount of management you need to do. But at the end of the day, what we've seen in the past is courts have pushed back and said, I don't want to see all these darn subleasing cases.
Right.
The judges say to the landlord, are you being paid on time every month?
He said, yeah.
Well, yeah. Well, why are you here? You signed an agreement.
He wants more money. He wants a piece of that action.
Well, no. What happens with the courts is they just get overwhelmed with all these subleasing cases.
Okay.
And I tell people, we already got what we consider one of the fullest dockets on the West Coast already in Portland, Oregon. Anybody who's had any divorces or legal issues, you know, so imagine just 500 cases a year for subleasing, hitting the courts, just 500, let alone the potential of what, 2,000 or 3,000? I just think at the end of the day that the landlords are going to lose out simply because the landlords, I mean the courts are going to say of all the cases that are before us right now, this is one of the least important. You understand what I'm talking about? I mean, this is really a situation that the city council is setting up for the city of Portland. That at the end of the day, if you live in a household where you make less than $75,000 a year, and especially if you're a person of color, you're basically being intentionally priced out of Portland.
And you also mentioned something once about how a lot of landowners won't keep up the property, and then the buildings turn into really bad, like in New York that happens.
Well, yeah. What rent control comes in on that is when you put a cap on revenue but not a cap on cost, especially a market like ours where we've got two major bond issues that people are working on that's going to raise property taxes significantly. Landlords can't afford to invest in the properties. So they start dragging their feet about investment, and this is the development of slums. Now, this is where cash-rich people they thrive, because as these properties degentrify, they come in and they buy them, and then they can even maybe afford to buy out the lease for the tenant that's in there, and then they tear down the property or refurbish the property, and then they either sell it or lease it to even wealthier people.
Right.
So anybody who's a progressive or a Democrat, if you call yourself a liberal and you support rent control in Portland, Oregon, a market that is having anywhere between 1,000 to 10,000 new residents move to it every month, depending who you talk to, you're not as liberal as you think you are. You're more like Trump and less like Obama. Matter of fact, you're more like Trump and less like than Martin Luther King or anybody that we know is de facto liberal. Because basically, you're saying, now is the time for the city of Portland to start turning over its real estate to the richest people in the market, literally.
So what do we do?
Well, wait a minute.
Don, what do we do?
I spent 15 years in property management, as a manager and as a maintenance person in some big properties around here. And my thing was, if I'm the manager, you're not going to get away with very much, because I have the right of inspection, and you're not going to sublease under my nose. So what I'm saying, what you're saying, is I'm seeing a lot of mismanagement. Yeah. If you're not if you're managing your property so that you're allowing people to sublease and getting away with it under your nose, then you probably should find another line of work.
Well, Don, you're right, but the problem is, like I said, the more efficient you are, let's say you're a property manager right now, the more people you're going to be sending into court, right?
No.
Well, no, you are, because if you find somebody who's subleasing and they shouldn't, the only recourse you have is to cancel the lease, and that means in this case, you're going to have to evict them for cause. And that is a legal action. You're going to have to evict them. It's in their best interest to fight it, because it may take them a year. For that case to get in front of a judge. Mm-hmm. And that year may equal X amount of dollars. Okay. You understand?
Tearing things all
the you understand? So, I mean, you know, this is a situation where, you know, yes, I truly believe, Don, you would do what you said because you're efficient. You've always been that type of person. But that's exactly what will break the system.
Well, look, let's go back a ways.
Good management will break the system.
Yeah.
Let's go back. Now, I'm going to throw this on the table. Okay, fine. You're saying, okay, fine. The person leases a piece of property for 3 years. Got three bedrooms in there. He lives in one. Mm-hmm. No, he's got two there. And I'm just saying, you got two that's sitting there. He might be putting books in it or this, that, and the other. Mm-hmm. But then all of a sudden, he gets short trying to make his rent. Mm-hmm. Say, hey, John is having a beer with someone. Say, hey, look here, why don't you move in my place, man? Tell you what, can you offset $200 to offset my rent? I mean,
or $600 or $800
or $800, whatever you want. And if the guy says yes, fine. Yeah. If the guy says no, he got to go to someone else.
That's
but my point is that now they're in. Now, but right here, this business about subleasing. Are you saying that particular person who already has a lease now will actually go through a formal process and have that prisoner sign up for a lease?
No, it's all under the table.
It's all under the table.
Okay, so there's no such thing as a subleasing.
What
you call it?
It's like an unofficial sublease.
It's considered subleasing or subrenting because the person who has the leasehold is making the agreement with somebody else.
But it still comes down to the bottom line. I can't afford to stay here because Don just raised the deal, and I'm trying to stay here. I need a couple of extra bucks. I got Teresa here. Do you want to rent the spot?
Oh.
Yes, I will. I can still stay here. He's happy
because
he's getting his money.
Bruce, usually,
I'm happy because I'm still there. Teresa's happy because she got a place to stay because she can't afford the whole rent.
Bruce,
what's the deal?
Bruce, that usually that's not how it comes around. You got to remember, when you have rent control, the rent is frozen. So if they couldn't afford it, they wouldn't have gotten it in the first place. Usually people do this, the subleasing, to make money, to make life easier on themselves.
Yeah.
You understand? Even though a guy can afford $1,500 a month, if he can rent out a bedroom for $1,000, why not?
And, to somebody who just moved to town who doesn't know who owns the building, he can say, you know, they just raised my rent $1,000.
Yeah.
It's $2,000 now, even though it's maybe only $1,000. They can lie,
they can
finagle, and they can do it all under the table.
This is a big problem in every market that has rent control. But this is one of so many problems.
So how do we solve it?
The only way to solve the problem with housing in Portland is to build more housing. The city of Portland.
But can they afford those houses?
No, the city of Portland. The more houses that are built, the lower the pressure. There will be upward pressure on rents, and you will see first rents start stagnating. And even though it hasn't happened in almost 70 years, you will see rents retract a little bit if we build enough housing.
But I don't see that. I mean, no. I see up in Northeast Portland, I got houses stacked up on one another, and the rents are still going
up. Well, there's other areas we need to build along. Like I was saying on Facebook
today. You like that development, that high-rise stuff?
I like it, but I would like to see more along Burnside, where the light rail is already. I'd like to see a lot more along there.
What about 82nd?
Parking?
Everybody's got a car. What do you do with that?
Well, no, there's ways to fit that in if we build correctly in places that we can do it. I mean, we're not building housing along 82nd. We're not building housing along 122nd. We're not building houses along that corridor for the light rail.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if we did that, we could probably fit in 30 or 40,000 units in those areas that I just talked about right there. 30 or 40,000 units, we could probably have on the ground in the next 3 to 4 years. And as those units are coming to market, mm-hmm. you're going to see the pressure of rent, the upward pressure on rents decrease. You're going to see to the point it may even stagnate like it did 20 years ago. 20 years ago.
Okay.
Well, think about it. I mean, anybody who's lived in Portland over the last 20 years, don't you remember those times when people, landlords were like giving away everything?
I do.
You know, they were saying first month's rent, no problem.
I
mean,
the good old
over
days.
There off of Twilliger Boulevard, I remember those new apartments that came on like in 2000, first 3 months free.
Yeah, I know.
You had 1 month deposit, and then 3 months after that was for free.
Oh, yeah.
And that was because the supply was above the demand.
Yeah.
We got to go back to those days. And people may think, well, how come we're out of those days today? Where interest rates are low, how come we're not doing it? A lot of it is the cost of land has gone up.
Yeah.
And the city of Portland is one of the most expensive cities on the West Coast to build a home. I'm trying to build a sixplex right now, and it's cracking me up how much money I'm spending per door. I'm right now at about $35,000 a door, and the estimate is I'm going to be at about $65,000 a door before...
Wait a minute, $65,000 a door. What do you mean?
For permits and fees.
Oh, okay. I mean, you're saying a door to me.
No. I'm talking about per unit. So six times. What I've been told is I can expect to spend about $65,000 per unit, per door, before I put the first shovel in the ground.
Oh, Lord.
And I've heard higher numbers.
Better find yourself a tent.
Well, no, this is what I was telling people. When you're looking at permitting costs that are this high, it goes directly, in a market like we've got, to limiting the ability to build affordable housing.
Okay. Well, look, let's get into another subject here.
Okay.
We'll have more chats about this one. Now, we've got a newly elected mayor in the city of Portland. His name is Ted Wheeler. Mm-hmm. He's having problems.
Yeah.
He's
had a lot of bad luck.
Yeah, a lot of bad luck. I mean, is the guy good? Is he good for Portland?
Ted's good for Portland, better than any of the other choices.
Why?
Ted will figure it out.
No, what do you mean, figure? Yeah. You know, when you get that job, it's not about figuring. You better start doing something.
Ted never wanted to be mayor of Portland until, you know, recent things changed at the state level. You know, and his whole goal has always been to our governor or possibly even higher than that. But I think Ted's going to eventually figure this out. He has to, you know, he has to learn how to be a little bit more combative than he's used to being.
Well, one thing, no man's an island. I mean, I don't know.
I saw him on Straight Talk with Laurel Porter, and he really impressed me. He's really, really smart, and he's quick. He seemed a little stressed out, but I think that you're right. I think he does need to learn to be a little more assertive.
Yeah, but we got issues. You still have to deal with people. You got to be very people savvy, if you will. I mean,
yeah, but he's think he is.
But he's got a very eclectic group of people on city council.
Who is that?
That he's got to deal with. Probably the most eclectic we've had in the last 30 years.
Yeah.
He's got somebody. I mean, Chloe Udaly, most of the city commissioners before us, probably are surprised that she's even there.
Mm-hmm. Well, you ran against her.
I ran against her.
Okay, well, watch what you say when you make that.
No, I'm not going to watch what I say. It's true.
We just had Women's Day.
I mean,
We just had Women's Day.
I got a white woman on city council is trying to kick every black person in Portland out of city.
A white
city
woman?
Portland, yeah.
Really? Which one is that?
It's Chloe. Chloe knows what rent control does.
Come on now.
No, Chloe knows. Chloe knows what rent control does to minorities, and she's accepted that consequence.
Now, you know, when
she's
you say
got problems.
She's got issues.
She's got real issues.
She's got issues.
And things are getting out about her too. She's very very unprofessional.
Yeah, but the bottom line,
I'm looking at what she's done.
But the bottom line is this: she ran for city council and she won, and she had a platform. And I think the housing thing. I mean, the rent control was one of her major pieces.
Yeah.
And my point
it was.
Is,
yeah,
I don't.
And it is on the table.
And you know what?
Well, the issue with Chloe Udaly is she just doesn't really understand the finer points and the really deep considerations of rent control and what it
entails.
Oh, I disagree. Well, I just don't.
Yeah. I've
talked to her, and she's got some incredible housing people that work in her office.
Okay.
Incredible smart people.
Okay.
People that used to work for Gretchen Kefouri.
Okay.
These guys know exactly what the consequences are of rent control.
So she's there.
And they've accepted it.
So then they just Ted.
I mean,
does Ted rely on her to basically get IE to be able to?
You know, I think up until now, maybe he is, maybe he still is. I don't know, but I do know this. Everybody on city council that voted for rent control the way it is right now has accepted the consequence that it's going to accelerate the diversification, or I should say, the end of diversification of the city of Portland. It is literally kicking minorities out of Portland.
It's going to make Portland whiter.
It's going to make Portland whiter and wealthier.
Now listen,
just like Tom Metzger said 30 years ago.
Now you made this other point. Let's be a little bit more specific. You know, we've got about 100 or so more languages being spoken in this country.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you say minority, what do you mean? Are you talking about 100 different cultures?
Well, what you got to do is you got to go back and look at the Urban League State of the Black Population of Portland. If you look at that report, it basically shows that the majority, not majority, but half of the black population, and that half is most of the black renters.
Okay, okay.
They are in the bottom 30% of the economic scale.
So you're talking about black folks.
So basically,
when
black
folks. When you say minority, I mean white folks all in that area.
Well,
too.
Black folks and people of color. I'll say that because Hispanics fall in that area.
How about Asians? The Asians fall in that area?
Not as many. Not as many, but even some. It basically comes
Chinese,
down to.
Filipinos.
It basically comes down to you've got 22,000 black people that are renters in Portland,
right?
In the city limits of Portland.
Okay.
You've got about 350 white people that are rent in the city limits of Portland. And that's about a 1 in 13. So for every 13 renters out there trying to rent a unit, one of them is black. We've got 10 units available. You understand? So we've got that 13 going for the 10. And if you just look at it numerically and just take race out as far as the decision-making on who gets a unit or not, odds are, under rent control, black people are going to be basically 75% in the first 10 years.
Well, Fred, now, let's talk about how much money has been spent in the Northeast Port, even from a HUD standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they've got long-term leases, if you will, as far as HUD was concerned, responding, if you will, to the whole issue about blacks and being gentrified in that particular area. What are you saying? Is HUD evicting them also?
No, most of those leases didn't go to black people. That's one thing that people don't pay attention to.
Who did they go to?
They went to white people.
Oh, really?
Most of them.
But that was portrayed out there from the standpoint.
But you see, Bruce, you got to understand something. We're not building that many of those houses. We're not building public housing in Inner Northeast Portland right now. So you're talking about housing that was developed in the 90s. You're not talking about anything that's been developed in the 2000s.
Well, wait a minute. Charlie Hill just dropped 20-some-odd million or so, and then
that has not hit the street yet. And
is that going to be just for black folks?
He says it is. I don't know how he's going to do it legally. This is what I don't like about rent control. It sets up the situation where now you got to make choices on who can live where based on their color and not let the market decide. Yeah. In other words, the only way to keep black people from being literally kicked out of Portland, we're talking about maybe 20,000 people eventually, Portland, is to say only black people can buy or lease certain pieces of property. And I don't want to live in a society where we start making decisions on where you can live based on your race. That's what we just left. You know, we literally just left that. So this rent control issue is something where somebody who supports it, they've decided that black people should take one for the white team and understand that there's no way to fix it.
Okay.
But you're saying that Chloe Udaly is aware of these considerations.
Absolutely. Her entire office. I know two or three people in her office extremely well.
Yeah. So let her do a job.
They work for Gretchen Kefouri.
Okay. But she's not.
No, is her job to kick black people out of Portland?
Yeah, I don't.
Wait a minute. Is that her job?
No,
wait a minute. Yeah.
I thought you said that was one of the deals that she's responsible for. How many white people voted for her wanting rent control, right? Not knowing they were voting for somebody that we got, you know, that's going to make the area more, less diverse.
So she's not sensitive to black, is that what you're saying?
Oh, she says she is, but she's not. She's not.
I believe that. I believe Fred when he says that.
Wow.
Of things that I've seen.
Is that
seen.
Right, really? Right.
Yeah.
And heard about her.
Well, city.
And witnessed myself.
Oh, is that right? Jeez. Yeah. City host.
I mean,
will you contact her and get her on the show, please?
You know what they say. You know what they say, Bruce. It's not what you say, it's what you do.
Yes, right.
You understand?
Right.
Look, I got about 30 seconds or whatever. This has been just great, and that's exactly what we're supposed to be doing here. So I really appreciate it very much, Fred.
Mm-hmm.
And hey, welcome aboard. We got to get you on here more often.
Yeah, anytime.
Don's got to be doing his thing more too. Okay, folks. Thank you very much. Right. Okay, folks. Okay. I guess you got it. You got the format. We're gonna really get in some good stuff, and the whole idea is for us to communicate and educate. That's what the Oregon Voters Digest is all about. And we'd suggest, if you will, those black papers that you know, Scanner and the Observer.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they should start printing the news about black folks, right?
Yeah, they should.
Okay, good. With that, take care, folks. Have a good one. See you next week.